Right. Clinical negligence cases are very complicated. They require experts. They require very complex issues. A very difficult issue is causation. What legally caused or materially contributed to the injury? And that requires expert lawyers. We have an adversarial court system. We haven't got a no-fault-based system. We're looking at that with the rapid resolution scheme for maternity injuries at the moment in the UK. But how do we balance all these interests? How do we also reflect the doctor's interests and the nurse's interests? An accident is terrible for them as well, and it can affect their confidence. But similarly, the patient under the tort system is designed to be put in the position they would have been in had the tort not occurred. And how can money compensate for the loss of a faculty or an amenity? It's a very difficult balance. And you can look at the UK as a model, and it's a good system. It's made incremental progress, but we've still got lessons. 10% of hospitals we were very concerned about, and the main concern about hospitals in the UK by the regulator is patient safety, and that people are not, as doctors or nurses and others, learning the lessons of past events and taking those seriously. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor John Tingle. Now I request Dr. Nikhil Dathar, Medical Director and Senior Consultant, Cloud 9 Hospital, Mumbai, to take over to explain the position in India.
Well, good afternoon, friends. Professor Muzumdar here, Dr. Rajiv Gurpur, madam. Thank you very much for invitation. And request to the young lady, please count my minutes from now. Okay. I bring greetings from this organization called Patient Safety Alliance, which is probably the only Indian organization that works on empowering patients on one hand, as well as supporting healthcare professionals to prevent medical harm and medical errors. It is well known that medical errors is the fifth common cause because of which people in the world die. Almost 10% of the people going to the hospitals are harmed by the medical care, and India probably must be witnessing close to about 5.2 medical injuries per year. On the index of safety, healthcare is as safe or as unsafe, you want to call it, as bungee jumping or mountain climbing, which we all know is considered as an adventurous sports or activity. Extensive work done by the premier organizations have made us understand two things. Number one, humans are error prone. So being error prone is being human. And second is it is usually the faulty systems which make good people fail all the time. Seminal work done by Lucien Leap has shown that although half of the adverse events are preventable, just around 1% of them really fulfill the real criteria of being called as negligent acts. In spite of this, many people in the healthcare believe, and also in general public believe, that medical errors are mistakes caused by individual people. They are the episodes of individuals who fail doing things the way they should be doing or not doing. And this is how it starts with this blame and shame culture. So you have this doctor over here who has some adverse, unexpected, unanticipated event, and he is sitting over here. And you have the other doctor and the relatives and the media and the police and the politicians and the cats and the dogs and the monkeys and the donkeys all trying to point fingers at him and ridiculing him. Blame, we all know, is a very powerful weapon. However, the self-blame, that's blaming one's own self for the acts done or have had happened in the hands, as well as blame from the system, that's from the hospital or the other colleagues, and the blame from outside the system, that's from the outside society, are all important and are all going to make the difference. So why do patients take legal recourse? So they want to correct the deficient services, they want to enforce accountability. Obviously, I mean, there are many such reasons for which they want to take the legal recourse, and not necessarily for the purpose of blaming someone else. And they have some genuine concerns as well. In India, out-of-pocket expenditure on health is very huge. Rectifying the damage caused by the adverse event can take severe toll on not only physical and mental health, as well as the financial health too. And that's why they have no other alternative but to go to the court and sue. So, is litigation a solution? Is it a bane or a boon? I must say very clearly that deterrence of the law has definitely helped to bring in awareness about the risk management amongst the medical professionals. The legal risk is being managed pretty well, but what about the medical risk management? And what about the patient safety? In fact, defensive practices have started creeping in and have becoming an increasing norm. So has litigation really improved the quality of healthcare? Has it improved the patient safety? Well, I have few doubts about it. And particularly in India, you've got so many avenues available where you can technically take the healthcare professional to. We know that Supreme Court in Jacob Matthews' case stated that indiscriminate prosecution of doctors, particularly under the criminal law, is counterproductive. Way back in 2008, the Supreme Court had directed the government to frame guidelines in order to decide and also take help from the medical council. But no action has been taken about this till date. By the government, as well as by the medical councils, nothing has been done. There has been a complete silence. Supreme Court concluded that while dealing with medical cases, the word gross has to be read along with Section 304A of the Indian Penal Code. Supreme Court had ordered the police to take medical opinion from the doctors from the government hospital before prosecution gets started. But do police ask the right question about the grossness of negligence to the doctors' committee? And are those doctors trained enough to understand what's the meaning of gross while dealing with criminal prosecutions occurring? So what is the outcome? The criminal prosecution starts, the cases are stretched for 20 years, ultimately the doctors is absolved of the criminal charges, the patients and the doctors both struggle for 20 years agony, and the system really does not serve the spirit of the Supreme Court judgment. The Dr. P.B. Desai case is the evident example of the same situation. Now let's look at the civil law. The focus is primarily negligence. Patients have to prove that someone is negligent or blameworthy. The blame has to be fixed. Unless and until this is done, the patients are not going to get compensation. The legal system does not want to encourage the non-adversarial alternate dispute redressal mechanism. And even the Indian medical indemnity system does not want to promote the alternate dispute redressal mechanism. So typically speaking, the health laws do not keep pace with the time. Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act is the glaring example of the same thing. Now let me say two sentences. Sentence number one, XYZ negligently performed the job. And the sentence number two, errors occurred in the hands of one Mr. X. Now technically speaking, we all know that both mean the same thing, things have gone wrong. But the level of culpability that we are trying to express is different. And this is exactly what is not addressed by the Indian law. So I have not heard of any single judgment in which the court has awarded compensation for deficiency of services and not for negligence. So I feel that it is the inherent gratification achieved by blaming or calling someone as negligent that seems to be the prerogative of the law rather than benefiting or helping somebody. Learning from various industries, the WHO recommends certain kinds of things, such as certain kinds of strategies. Now let's look at the first three, the error reporting and learning from the errors, open disclosure of errors and transparency, educating and empowering the patients. So my question is that if at all we think that this is possible in a very heavily blame-riddled culture, probably the answer is going to be no. We all know that patients and their relatives are the victims of the medical errors. In this cockfight, typically speaking, where one bird survives by making brutal attacks by sharp razors tied to its legs, the truth is that both are the victims of the system. The real difference here is that the law recognizes the healthcare providers as blameworthy and negligent, whereas the patient safety ideology recognizes them as second victims of medical errors. Well, friends, if we want to really speaking, break this conspiracy of silence around the medical errors, then it is imperative that we move from the culture of blame and shame to the culture of patient safety. So typically speaking, in patient safety culture, we accept that to err is human. The healthcare providers are supported and utilized rather than being condemned. The errors are openly disclosed. The whole situation actually encourages safety and risk management. The system becomes stronger and the words in the patient safety directory are now going to change. The word medical error is going to be now called as patient safety incidents. The word negligence is going to be replaced by deficiency, and fixing the blame is now going to be converted into no blame compensation to those people who are the victims of the medical errors. Well, friends, we all know that this is a very steep challenge. We all are aware of the fact that the society accepts technology very easily. However, accepting ideology is very, very difficult. But I believe, and we all should believe, that the world is of patients. Few of us, by the virtue of our education and qualifications, behave and perform as doctors. But even if we are doctors, we were patients, we are patients, and we will be patients at some point of time. So let us make world safer place and better place for the patients to live in, and that is what is Patient Safety Alliance stands for. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you, Dr. Dattar. We have assimilated many points if we were to have a takeaway from this track about how law should go. But we also have a demonstration of one of the strongest points which came out here, which is about non-adversarial justice. So now I request Dr. Kakde, Professor Shirish Kulkarni and team to take over the dais, and I request all the esteemed speakers to take your positions in the front row among the audience. As we prepare the dais for the legal medicine clinic, I also request the participants to be quick because we have the Honorable Minister already on the campus on his way, so we have only 25 minutes to wind up. So I request our stage committee to take over in the meanwhile as the dais is getting ready for the legal medicine clinic.
Thank you, ma'am. I would thank the speakers for their sheer experience and insights into the plethora of topic of the session, healthcare laws. Now I would like to call Deputy Director Ms. Dr. Samita Jadhav, Deputy Director of Symbiosis Institute of Health Sciences, to felicitate Dr. Shashikala Gurpur. I would request Dr. Shashilaka Gurpur to felicitate our speakers. Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, Chancellor, National University of Educational Planning and Administration, Delhi. I would request ma'am to felicitate Dr. Sanjay Gupte, past president, Federation of Obstetrics and Gynecology Society of India. Dr. Mohan Agashe, former director, Maharashtra Institute of Mental Health. Professor Chris Gledhill, Director of Clinical Legal Education, AUT Law School, Auckland, New Zealand. Dr. Santosh Kakde, CEO, Core India Institute of Legal Medicine. Ms. Sunita Singh Dalal, Partner, ACNH Legal Consultants, Dubai. Dr. Arsh Balasubramanian, President Swami Vivekanand Youth Movement. Professor John Tingle, Reader in Healthcare Law, Nottingham Trayton University, UK. Dr. Nikhil Dattar, Medical and Director, Senior Consultant, Cloud9 Hospital, Mumbai. As our honorable chief guest will arrive soon, we are arranging the stage. I would request Dr. Shashikala Gurpur ma'am to continue the quiz with the audience.
Are we ready for the legal medicine clinic? Are we?
Yes.
Is it all done? Yeah, Dr. Kakde, please come and take over, our mediator. And thereafter, audience, please don't go, stay with us. Once this clinic is over, you'll be grilled on recapitulating what has gone on for the last 2 hours through a quiz.
Good afternoon to you all. Welcome to this legal medicine clinic. Let me introduce myself. I am Dr. Santosh Kakde. You can call me as the mediator. Please be seated and introduce yourselves.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mediator. My name is Dr. Arun Vigmul, and I'm husband of Mrs. Leelavati, the victim in the present case.
Good afternoon. I'm Dr. Navya, the daughter of Mrs. Leelavati.
Good afternoon. My name is Sugandha Chaudhary. I am the lawyer for the complainant.
Good afternoon, Mr. Mediator. My name is Dr. Yashaswi Rora, and I'm the neurosurgeon for MG Hospital.
I'm Mr. S. Kulkarni, who is the hospital administrator.
Good afternoon. I'm Advocate Prakhar Tripathi, and I'll be representing the respondents.
Well, so good afternoon to you all once again. We now are here to proceed with the process of mediation. Let me explain this process of mediation. It will consist of four phases. The first one is a joint session, which we will now proceed with. Next will be individual session with each of the party, and then a combined session in which we are going to actually take the decision. Now, you all know that the process of mediation is a voluntary one. Now, in this process, you are going to talk to me and you are not going to raise your voices. You, one by one, I am going to interact with all of you. So, these are the four phases in which we are going to go ahead. Is that okay with you?
Yes, sir.
That's fine. So, this is the joint session. Now, I request the respondents to stay away from this particular session after the first one. So let us proceed with the session.
Thank you, Mr. Mediator. In the initial state, I would like to point out some facts in brief. In this case, my wife, Mrs. Leelavati, she's a renowned medical practitioner in the city. And on an unfortunate day, she slipped from the stairs and met with an accident. Immediately after that, we rushed to the hospital where Dr. Rora and the medical authorities of that hospital gave such a negligent act and a treatment, as a result of which my wife went into coma in a vegetative state, and due to which my whole family, my daughter, we have been suffering since such a long time. But though we belong to the same profession, same medical profession, we thought it deemed necessary to, you know, before initiating this tedious process of litigation, to come and initiate the talks, as we believe that talk leads to resolution of a dispute in an amicable manner.
Dr. Arun, stop hurling accusations at me and my hospital. It has already been proved by the evidences that when your wife was brought to our hospital, considering her age and other circumstances, the best treatment was given to her. According to the normal Glasgow coma scale, which was 15 by 15 throughout until the time she fell unconscious. And that is the reason I decided to wait and give her the conservative treatment.
Excuse me, best treatment? Is this what you call best treatment? You did not operate her SDH? Instead, gave her a conservative treatment and put her on observation. Is this what you call best treatment?
Doctor,
do you see the critical condition my mother is in right now? No, do you see, because of your negligence, the critical condition of my mother, because
like
of which
you're
suffering?
I would like to interrupt here for a while, because this session is going, deflecting its purpose. So would like to call in the caucus session, in which we will definitely listen to all of you. So now there will be a separate session in which I will actually listen to the complainants, and till that time, the respondents will stay out. So I request them to make themselves comfortable in the next row. Yeah, so, yes, Dr. Arun. Now, please proceed and let me know what has happened.
Sir, in the current situation, we want a strong apology from this hospital authority and Dr. Rora in a national newspaper, so that this whole society get to know what kind of disastrous act they have committed.
Mediator sir, in addition to an apology, we would also want them to pay us 2.5 crore rupees for all the mental agony and trauma that they've caused the family and the victim, and for all the medical expenses that they've already paid and will be paying for the treatment of the victim.
Dr. Arun, I think you being a part of medical fraternity, you yourself a general surgeon, the renowned general surgeon, how do you substantiate your lawyer's claim?
Mr. Mediator, that's a very valid question. I appreciate your eagerness to know that. Being, you know, belong to the same medical profession. As for the medical literature and the medical records available at our disposal, you must be aware that whenever the CT scan of brain shows subdural hematoma of more than 1 centimeter and midline shift of more than 5 millimeter, one has to be operated upon in that situation, in whatever may be the neurological status of the patient. And you are aware that in the case of my wife, she had SDH, that is subdural hematoma, of more than 5 centimeter thickness. You may note that. More than, 2 centimeter thickness. And midline shift of more than 10 millimeter. So though she was in a conscious state, but as per the medical record, she should have been operated. Although the normal Glasgow comma scale of 15 out of 50, 15 that Dr. Rora just quoted. I'm not denying that fact. But giving a conventional treatment to my wife is completely unacceptable, which proved disastrous to her health. Completely not acceptable to
so
me
Dr.
at all.
So Dr. Arun, can you... It will be, So Dr. Arun, do you have any confidential other information which can be shared with us right now?
Apart from this, I would like to share that my mother had a previous medical history of hypertension and diabetes, but I would appreciate if this information is not shared with the other party, otherwise it would weaken our case.
But mediator sir, even though she had all these medical conditions, it should not affect our case because they did not apply the Boolean test, and we have evidences in the form of medical literature to prove that their act was an act of medical negligence, and they should pay us compensation for it.
Okay, that's fine. So now I could understand your demands, that one is you need a compensation of 2.5 crores, and secondly, you also need a public apology. So let us have a caucus session of... So now, since there's a time limit, now I will just announce that this session is over, because now the respected guests, they have arrived. Now, in a brief, the mediation is alternate dispute resolution system. In this case particularly, old lady actually suffered from subdural hematoma, but since she was not operated upon in time, please come and sit for a minute, she suffers from a vegetative state. So this problem we have selected to demonstrate that how a mediation process actually goes on. Now here, both the parties discuss one by one and they demand, and it's a voluntary process in which they come to a conclusion. Because they belong to the medical profession as such, they don't want to go for litigation and they don't want to go for further harassment of both the parties. So with this, let me come to an end of this. Thank you very much for patient listening. Definitely we will take another opportunity to give a presentation in definitely better manner. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Please be seated as our Honorable Chief Minister will arrive soon. And we soon begin with the inauguration ceremony. Thank you.
I would request the technical committee to facilitate Sachin to conduct the quiz in the well of the auditorium because the stage is being set for the next function.
Let's take the mic.
We'll just take the mic. Okay. Thank you, Dr. Kakde.
Thanks, madam. Yeah.
I'll go down and do it. Your time, and I'm going to be asking two more questions. Just the same routine that we did in the last instance we did the quiz. I'm going to be showing the question on your screen, and if you happen to know the answer, please raise your hand, introduce yourself very briefly, and tell us what you think the answer to the question is. All right. So the first question you see on your screen, so now this is, again, it's a very topical question in the sense that this is something that's as current affairs as of today. By what nickname do we know the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act? So there's a certain name, a nickname that's given to this, and there's a lot of furore over it, especially today, for a specific reason. I'll come to that when I explain the answer. So I saw that gentleman's hand go up first, sir. If you could just stand up and tell us your name and what you think the answer is. Somebody's going to, just one sec, sir, just one sec. The mic is coming your way. So you could just introduce yourself and tell us what you think the answer is.
My name is Dr. Pramod Gawai.
Okay,
Dr. Gawai. I'm working as a medical superintendent in government organization.
Okay.
And that is the Consumer Protection Act.
This is the Consumer Protection Act is what you say. Unfortunately, that's not the correct answer, Dr. Gawai. I'll take the mic from you and I will come to this gentleman right in the front. I'll come to you next, madam. I'll just go to sir here. Sir, if you could introduce yourself and tell us what you think the answer is.
I'm Dr. Rajesh. I'm a gynecologist and a medical director in a 100-bedded hospital. It's called Obamacare.
It's called Obamacare. How many of you think that it's Obamacare? That is the correct answer. So this is Obamacare. In fact, just a couple of hours ago, earlier today, the Obamacare, as we know, at least provisions of it, was repealed in the House by the Republican Party. And there is an equivalent bill by the Republican that's going to be passed. So that's why we thought we'll frame this question around the context of healthcare and law. I've got one more question, and this is the last question that I've got for you today, after which we'll have a recap session through Dr. Gurpur. Can we just have a look at the slide, please? Goodies, of course, sir. Goodies are coming your way. That's the most important thing. Thank you for bringing that to our notice. There is a goodie coming your way. I've got that coming your way. Can we have a round of applause for Doctor, please? Yeah. My bad, I missed that. So that's for sir right there. Next question, and okay, so this is something that was mentioned through all the discussions with the speakers, and they mentioned about how the healthcare bill is something that is a very, very, a great piece of lawmaking as is. So now I've got four provisions that I've got, which I've mentioned on your screen. One of them happens to be not a provision that is part of the healthcare bill of 2013, all right? So the first one says that a person who attempts suicide shall be presumed to be suffering from a mental illness at that time and will not be punished under the Indian Penal Code. That's supposed to be the provision. Second, advanced directive that states how a mentally ill person wants to be treated for the illness during a mental health situation and who will be his or her nominated representative shall be. Third is that electroconvulsive therapy is allowed for minors. And the third is that every person shall have the right to access mental health care and treatment from services run or funded by the government. Okay, so if you guys do it this way, I can't give chocolates to all of you. I need to have one person. Sir, yes, right? Since you've been most... Yes. C. So if you say C is incorrect, what is the actual provision of the law then? No. So he's absolutely correct. So C is incorrect. In fact, electroconvulsive therapy is prohibited for minors completely as per the bill. And that's why that was the incorrect statement there. What is your name, sir? Sorry?
My name is Anuj Kumar Singh from Symbiosis College of Nursing.
Anuj Kumar Singh from Symbiosis Nursing. He gets himself a prize, and that is the end of the quiz. Yes, I can continue. Okay, I've got more questions, so I'm going to continue. All right,
This is another interesting provision, since the speaker spoke about how that, in fact, Gurpur ma'am mentioned about how in Karnataka, the National Law School there is being brought on board to create a new nuanced bill that includes and has more governance for private institutions. So now there are two regulatory acts that you have. One is the rules and then the act, which is the Karnataka Private Medical Establishment Act of 2007 and the rules of 2009. Now that regulates the functioning of private hospitals in Karnataka. However, only one system of medicine comes under the purview of the act. Now you've got four options. You've got homeopathy. Please raise your hands, guys, so that I can give you a prize. Otherwise, I can't give prizes to all of you. So you've got homeopathy, you've got naturopathy, you've got Unani, and then you've got allopathy. So let's go to someone from that side. I've not gone there at all. Yes, sir. If you could just, mic coming away, you can introduce yourself. Tell us what you think the answer is. And yeah.
Hello, I'm Dr. Hemant Dahake. Okay. Answer is allopathy.
The answer is allopathy. That is fairly straightforward. That is the right answer. So the only sort of system of medication, of course, that's governed by the act is allopathy. Now you do have something called the Ministry of Ayush. You've heard of that? What does Ayush stand for? Ayurveda, Yoga, Unani, Homeopathy and Siddha. Exactly. So that's what those other systems are governed within that ministry. And these central acts, the state acts are governed under allopathy. Now, yeah.
Thank you, Sachin. Now we have to look at the wrap-up of today's track. In the wrap-up, the era of self-regulation is over, particularly for the healthcare profession. Now, what does that mean? That means that unless you are really self-regulating yourself honestly in public interest, it's going to be a difficult time. And most of the recent legislations in India are reflecting this point. For example, the mental health care bill, which we spoke earlier about in the first part of the session, clearly shows that the preamble itself begins by reiterating the International Disability Convention, which was signed under the United Nations Organization's aegis. In fact, the second aspect of global healthcare across the world has revealed many best practices to you, and Indian law has reflected that. Thirdly, when we look at global best practices, today in India, generic medicine prescription has become a rule. Prime Minister Modi revealed it in one of the meetings. So today what has happened is outsourcing private care is one of the best practices in Thailand, because government itself cannot cater to good quality practice. Either public healthcare assumes that kind of quality, or quality healthcare available in private sector is outsourced. These are some of the options that policy will have to look into. So also, generic drug has to be dispensed with the government supervision, as in Malaysia. So if you look at that, India could become a world leader in healthcare only if such best practices are adopted and our policy is reviewed. I want to ask you, should it be a co-regulation in terms of new policy, or should it be a no regulation, or it should be better self-regulation left to the healthcare professionals? Think about it as I invite Dr. Madho Menon to have the last sentence of this track. Over to you, sir.
Well, it was indeed a very instructive and very interesting comparative assessment of the type of problems that the legal regime will have to confront with if you want to develop universal healthcare system, plus through health services delivery, you want to be a leader, and trade in health services is to be possible. I think on the question of mental health, we have taken the right step forward. That's what the mental health policy, as well as the act, seems to underline. All the best practices that Shashikala talked about have been brought in. But as one of the speakers mentioned, law in the books is one thing, and law is in practice is different, particularly in India. That is where the health professionals will have to put their house in order, so that things will...